William Morrow and Harper Audio present The Sky Vault by Benjamin Percy, performed by Michael David Axtell. For Lisa. Prologue. It begins with a comet. Decades ago, an infrared telescope captured the thermal emissions streaking through the solar system. Eventually, it was determined to be 300.2 kilometers wide and orbiting the Sun in an elongated ellipse that would bring it within 500,000 miles of Earth. The Moon, by comparison, is 238,900 miles away. This would be, scientists said, a beautiful light show that everyone should enjoy all the more, knowing that we'd narrowly escape planetary annihilation. The official name of the comet was P2011C9, but most people called it Cain, the surname of the astronomer who'd discovered it. 20 years later, it burned into view and made its close pass by Earth. People took off work. They gathered at soccer fields and in parking lots, on rooftops and along sidewalks, setting up lawn chairs and picnic blankets and grills and coolers as though readying for a fireworks display. Everyone suddenly owned a telescope. Vendors sold comet t-shirts and hats and keychains and plush stuffed toys. Surfers stacked up on beaches waiting for the big waves they believed would come from the gravitational flux. At least two cults killed themselves off, announcing this was the end of the world and the comet a gateway to the vault of heaven. Professors and scientists and religious leaders became regular guests on cable news shows, where they talked about how comets had long been associated with meteorological and human disasters, tsunamis, earthquakes, and droughts. In 44 BC, when Caesar was assassinated, his soul was said to depart the Earth and join the comet flaming overhead. In AD 79, a comet aligned with the eruption of Vesuvius. In AD 684, when Halley's comet passed by, the Black Death broke out. And in 1066, when it made another appearance, William the Conqueror won the Battle of Hastings. Celestial judgment and providence, or an instrument of the devil, as Pope Calixtus III called it. Heaven knows what awaits us, one professor said. It is a reminder of our irrelevant smallness and accidental existence in the universe, a glimpse of something violently outside the bounds of human existence, as close as you can come to seeing God. Local news reporters interviewed people on the streets. I don't know, it's just kind of cool, one man said. Special. Once-in-a-lifetime sort of deal. You want to be able to say, I was there. It's almost like we're living this two-dimensional life, and now there's this sense of it being three-dimensional, if you know what I mean. Cain looked like a roughly drawn eye, some said, or a glowing animal track, or a slash mark in the fabric of space, a wandering star. For a few days, the comet made night uncertain, hued with a swampy green light. And by day, the sky appeared twinned with suns. And then, gradually, the comet trailed farther and farther away, and people forgot all about it. Until 1 year passed. The planet finished its orbit of the sun and spun into the debris field left behind by the comet, the residue of Cain's passage. This June, the sky would fall. That's what the newscaster said. The meteor shower was not as long-lasting as August's Perseids, but for several nights, the sky flared and streaked and wheeled, the constellations seeming to rearrange themselves with ever-shifting tracts of light. At first, hundreds, and then thousands, and then hundreds of thousands, and finally, an uncountable storm of meteors. The ground shook. Windows shattered. Grids of electricity went dark. Satellites shredded. Radio signals scrambled. Dogs howled, and people screamed their prayers. Many of the meteors dissolved in the atmosphere, but many struck the Earth, sizzling into the ocean, splintering roofs, searing through ice, punching craters into fields and forests and mountainsides, like the seeds of the night. It was then that everything changed. 1. Sometimes when Chuck Bridges takes a long, hard look at his life, he feels like a time traveler who ended up in the wrong place, one of those alternative futures where things went haywire. He should have hair, for one. His hair had been glorious, thick, inky curls that gave off a kind of light, like an oil puddle in a parking lot or something. Also, he should be a well-respected mayor, or an important scientist guy, or maybe the beloved host of one of those programs about UFOs and Bigfoot on the Discovery Channel. Also, he shouldn't be in a cell. He'd been arrested before. A New Year's DUI, a fistfight at a county fair, a protest march in Anchorage. But not for years, and not for anything serious. Not like this. Port Authority had been waiting at the end of the jet bridge, and as soon as the plane engines quieted to a whine, the flight attendant unlocked the cabin door and the cops marched in. They found Chuck in his 20th row seat, and when he said, "I don't know what you're looking at me for, I didn't do nothing wrong," they yanked him up and twisted his arms behind his back and cuffed his wrists. "You should be thanking me," he said. "I was trying to save their lives. I'm a goddamn hero." They escorted him up the jet bridge and along the concourse and through a locked door and down the stairs and into a hall that ended with a windowless cell in the basement of the Fairbanks International Airport. He tries telling them the same thing he's been telling everybody else, but they won't listen. It goes like this. Cumulus, cirrus, altostratus, nimbostratus. Clouds have names, right? But even though the sky is ever-shifting, the cloud atlas doesn't change. It's more like the color wheel than the dictionary or star charts. The labels and order are firm. There is nothing more to discover. Except that there is. Chuck believes he has identified a new formation. On six different occasions, six, he has documented its existence. The photographs and videos on his cell are not comprehensive, in part because he really needs to order a new phone. The screen on this one is so cracked it doesn't function properly, and the weather events have been short-lived, dispersing after less than a minute. "But you should see it," he tells everyone. "It's wild, man." Its appearance in the clouds at first resembles a stormy sea, with sharp gray waves and pulpy black troughs. And then something shifts, and tendrils lower, like those of a jellyfish. A puckered swirl forms at the center, what could be described as an eye or a mouth. Then just as quickly as it began, it dissipates. Briefly apocalyptic is how he describes it. He has sent his files and arguments to both the National Weather Service and the World Meteorological Organization, and they have dismissed him. Not once, but repeatedly. Because he won't let up. Several scientists and meteorologists have blocked his phone number and email, and a few even filed for restraining orders against him because they are, in their words, exhausted by the insane ramblings of a hobbyist and conspiracist. Of course, he takes offense. Not at the conspiracist jab, that's fine. It's the hobbyist label that bugs him. He is, in fact, a meteorologist for 93.3, the Grizz, the fifth biggest FM market in North Central Alaska. Or maybe meteorologist isn't his official title. He's a classic rock disc jockey who also acts as the janitor for the station. But by God, he's been reporting on the weather for more than 20 years, 30-second updates every half hour. And that's got to count for something. What hair Chuck still has, he grows long. His wiry beard matches it, running halfway down his chest. He's long-limbed and bony, except for a prominent belly that makes him look like he's smuggling a basketball beneath the Hawaiian shirts he favors with his jeans and cowboy boots. He sometimes has at least three pairs of reading glasses on him. Cheaters, he calls them. One perched on top of his head, another on the tip of his nose, another dangling from a cord around his neck, because he misplaces them so frequently. And yes, it's true that he has a blog called The Truth Is Out There, that is responsible for inquiries into cloned celebrities, faked moon landings, microchipped vaccines, mind-controlled television programs, alien lizard people, Sasquatch, and the Bermuda Triangle of the North. But so what? So what? There's nothing illegal about any of that. The truth of the matter is this. He should get credit for discovering a new cloud system. But he won't, because he made the mistake of telling the NWS that something in the sky was trying to communicate with him. At least, he thinks it's in the sky. The first time he noticed it, the whispering in his headphones when he queued up Zeppelin, he wondered if he was picking up another frequency. And then he got this feeling, this tingle at the back of the neck feeling, that made him tear off his headset and spin around in his chair to make sure he was alone in the studio. That's when he saw it, out the window, the darkening sky, the lowering chutes, the swirling nexus. It happened again and again and again, over the course of several years. Not on any regular schedule, and not with any steady connection to the temperature or pressure system or moisture index. He recorded the whispers and played them for others, including his wife, but she only said, "Maybe it's the wind?" This was in their kitchen, where slices of Spam sizzled on a stovetop pan. "Maybe it's the wind," he said with a mean laugh. "That's what the stupid people say in horror movies before they get killed." She shut off the burner, and the meat continued to spit and pop. She crossed her arms and gave him a hard stare. "So I'm stupid, am I?"
"No," he said, realizing his mistake, stepping back. "No, that's not what I meant."
Her name was Janie, and she kept her hair and her nails cut short to avoid the fuss. She worked at the credit union as a teller and could butcher a deer in less than an hour, and didn't like much in the way of nonsense outside of the sitcoms she watched at night to relax. She had a way of inclining her head, like a boxer lining up a shot, that usually tipped him off to the fact a big fight might be coming. She was doing precisely that now when she said, "Then what did you mean?"
"I meant, I'm frustrated, is all. I feel like something's happening, something important, but I'm the only one who believes it."
He walked over to the kitchen table and flopped down in a chair and put his head in his hands.
"I'm sorry."
She found the spatula and scraped the Spam slices off the pan and onto a plate. She laid a paper towel over them to soak up the grease. Then she walked over to Chuck and rubbed his back and told him it was all right. But she was worried about him.
"You think I'm crazy, don't you? You always think I'm crazy."
"I don't always think you're crazy. I think some of your ideas are a little out there."
"This is different. This isn't some theory about Jack Parsons and the Jet Propulsion Lab, or Area 51, or the Hodag, or Mothman, or any of that."
"How is it different?"
"Because I saw it. I heard it. There's no distance or speculation. This is raw data, a first-hand account."
She said, "I think you should listen to the recording again."
"Fine, let's do that."
He set his phone on the table and called up the recording and hit the play button, and they both leaned in. It was as if one of his ears heard it as a whispering, urgent voice, and the other heard it as a scratchy recording of the wind.
"Maybe I should play it for Theo when he gets home."
"You should not play it for Theo."
"Why not?"
"Because he's 14 and he already thinks we're aliens and spends all his time with his friends. There's no reason to give him another excuse to roll his eyes." He squeezed the phone in his palm and stared at his ghostly reflection in the black screen.
"The whispering is one thing, but how do you explain the clouds?"
"Well, the TV signal doesn't come through as sharp when the weather gets rough. I'm guessing the same can be said for radio."
"I've been working at that station for how long? And there's been some enormous weather, some serious howlers. But I never noticed this, never, until we put up that omni-metal antenna."
"What are you suggesting?" He stood up from his chair and went over to the window. This was September, and the lawn was yellow weeds.
"I don't know."
"Well, until you do, maybe you should just take things down a notch."
but he couldn't. He sent off more emails and made more phone calls. He brought it up at his favorite bar, the Broken Mirror, and ended up getting a bowl of peanut shells dumped over his head. He brought it up on the air during his morning shift and ended up in trouble with the station owner.
The world is a strange enough place right now, don't you think? People don't need another reason to be scared, and they sure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.